So hi everyone. I hope you're not too tired after all the talks this day. There were really some good talks, especially Munch talk.
Oh, yeah. Sorry, it's fine. I'll just talk from here. Okay. So a little about myself. I work as a product engineer in Gojek. I work in a team called Lambda. It's not related to AWS Lambda at all. Basically, what our team does is we solve developer problems. Developers are our main customers. And the reason that this team was set up around a year back was to make developers' life easier. Now, what do I mean by that? What does making developers' life easier mean? So it changes from company to company, but in Gojek, the problem that we're facing now is deployment standardization. Am I audible now? Yeah. Am I audible now? I'll just shout. Okay. So.
It is on.
Hello.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, so what we're solving right now is standardizing deployments. Event sourcing is a problem that we're focusing on, and today's talk is about that, how we are enabling event sourcing in Gojek. So a little outline about today's talk. So we have released a framework called Ziggurat. So I'll explain what Ziggurat is and how we use it at Gojek. Why was Ziggurat incepted in the first place? I mean, what was the need of Ziggurat? Then Ziggurat has evolved over the past year along a lot of iterations. So I'll go through the iterations, explain what the problem was and how we solved it, what were the design decisions that we took. And finally, what impact has it had on Gojek? So how many of you don't know what Gojek is? No one? Oh, there are a couple of people. Cool. So think of Gojek as a super app where we have one app that has 18 products. So to give you an idea, you have Swiggy here that does food delivery. You have Uber, Ola that does ride hailing. You have Make My Trip, and then you have, so you can book movies using other websites. Gojek does all of that in one app. We do more than 100 million bookings per month, and we are currently in Indonesia, Singapore, Thailand, and Vietnam, and we are soon releasing in Philippines. So across all our products, we have more than 300,000 merchants that provide their services, and we act as, so we act, we don't aggregate their services, we have our own products, but we just plug their services into our own. Okay, so again, what is Ziggurat? So let's start. So Ziggurat is a stream processing framework. It's open source, by the way. So a lot of the code that you see today, you'll be able to find online on our GitHub repo. A lot of code has evolved over time, but the main gist of the code remains the same. So it should be easy to understand the code online. To explain what Ziggurat is, let me start with an example. We're in this room, right? It's pretty cold. I think everyone's feeling cold here. So let's say that we have a problem where we want to set up a service that automatically turns on and off the air conditioner based on the temperature of the room. So how would you do that? You need, so the most basic thing would be to set up a thermostat that it starts using temperature of the room every, say, it pulls it every 10 seconds. Now, you have the data, but you need a service to process that data and make the API call to command the AC to turn off or on, right? So let's say you have a stream of data now that varies over time. You store it in a database. Now, you set up a service that starts reading that data. Now, what that service needs is a way to manage offset as to, so it should manage that till where it has read the data and from where it should keep on reading. Then, so let's say the service starts reading data, you write some basic logic where you say that, okay, if the temperature goes above 41 degrees Celsius, turn on the AC. If it goes below something, turn off the AC. In an idle condition, it works fine and it should not be a problem. But we are not just simple engineers, right? We need to handle error cases. So let's say the command fails. The API call usually fails. So let's say the API call fails. and you don't want to sit in the heat or the cold for a long time. So you need some error handling where you say that, okay, if the API call fails, I need to retry that message so that I can retry the API call to the AC. And you also want to know that why did the API call fail at the first place, so you can fix the underlying problem. So you do that, you have some error handling in place and everything is working fine. Then I say that since we've set up a service, I should have some manual control of the AC as well. So now you need an HTTP server in your service so that you can manually send commands to the service to turn off the AC or turn on the AC. You put that in place as well. Now I complicate things a little bit more and say that I don't want the AC to run when there's no one in the room. So now how would you do that? So now you need another sensor that tracks the number of people in the room, and whenever someone goes and whenever the number of people are zero in the room, the AC should be turned off. So since you have another sensor, you have one more stream of data that your service needs to read. So now your service needs to support reading multiple streams of data and processing them simultaneously. This is all what Ziggurat does, and I'll explain how we evolved to this framework. This was not initially what Ziggurat was, but now it is. But before doing that, I'd like to explain what is possible with the correct tooling around Ziggurat and how we use it at Gojek. So as I mentioned, I am part of Team Lambda, and we've built a tool called Lambda. So what it does is it scaffolds code, it lets you edit config for services, it lets you deploy services. So as an example, let's say let's call our service Inspector Cool because it's managing the code. And you say that, okay, Lambda act in new Inspector Cool. It scaffolds code for you, it generates a repo with all the correct code in place. So we have a single namespace that's used for the logic. So if you look at this code, you have a start function, a stop function, a main function, and then the entry point to the code base. So when we started initially, what we wanted to build was something like AWS Lambda, where you just write the function belonging to your domain and everything is run on its own. Now it is not AWS Lambda, but this is a relic of that. So here if you see, the main function is where you write all your logic, and that main function is passed on to Ziggurat, and that function is applied to every message that is read from the stream. What start and stop functions here are state management functions. So whatever logic you write in the start function is run to initialize your application, and the stop function is run to gracefully shut down your application. So for our case, what we do is in the start function, we'll initialize the thread pool to make API calls to the AC. In the stop functions, we'll gracefully release the thread pools and gracefully shut down our application. Then in the main function, we have our main logic where we have a case on the temperatures and say that, okay, whenever the temperature is less than something, call the AC with the on parameter, and otherwise call the AC with the off parameter. You'll also see that we have some error handling here where we have some retry logic. I'll explain that later on how this works. Okay, so now you have this logic in place. You've written the logic for Inspector Cool. How would you deploy it to production? We have a CI setup to package applications manually, so to package applications in the CI. And so you get a package SHA for each application. So using a Lambda framework, you just say Lambda actor deploy Inspector Cool in which environment and what package you want to deploy. And it'll deploy in all clusters in, so what I mean by cluster is that for every country, we have separate clusters. So with this one command, you can deploy the same package to all countries with the correct config. And all the monitoring and alerting is also in place the moment you create the application. So once you deploy it, just run this command Lambda actor monitor, and you get this dashboard out of the box. So an application like this can be deployed within half an hour, and it'll be running in production without any problems. To explain what this dashboard is, the graph on the top left corner, that is the success rate. So how many messages does the application successfully process every minute? The one towards the right of it is how many failed messages are there per minute. Then on the second row, the left one is the throughput of your application. The one on the right is the total number of messages it has processed till date. On the bottom, the left one is the delay. So in every stream processing application or async job, there is a delay with when the event was created and when it was processed. So here we calculate the delay and we try to keep it in check. And the last one is, so if you go back, this was the main function is our mapper function that is mapped over every stream. So we also keep in check what the time each what the time the mapper function is taking to process each message, as that contributes the most to the lag. Okay, so now that we know what Ziggurat does and what it is capable of, let's understand why we built it in the first place. So in Gojek, we have a service called Ride Service. So when I mentioned that the products that we have, the Uber counterpart, the ride hailing part of Gojek, is Ride Service. This is the backend for that service. It has become a monolith over the years, where it has a huge dependency matrix. So for every call that you make, so every flow, there are around 30 dependencies that were called, at least till last year. There were 30 dependencies that were called in every major flow of the application. The uptime and maintainability was a problem. So every time the load on Gojek increased, Ride Service would generally buckle under load, not because of its own problems, but because one of its dependencies failed, and therefore our flow would also fail. So testing, QA, and deployments were also time-consuming, so it was a huge application. And there were a lot of sync and async requests that could be pulled out of Ride Service. To give you context, this is a basic flow of what happens at Ride Service. So whenever you book a ride, whenever you call for a driver to go to some place, an event is created. So a booking-created event is created. Then once we have some checks in place. So for example, you're booking a ride from here to Hyderabad. Now it does not make sense to book a ride that for such longer distance. So we have some checks in place, as in how long is the ride being requested for? Do I have enough balance for the ride? So if everything passes, we go on to confirm, booking confirmed. So now the booking is confirmed, everything is correct. After booking confirmed, we go to start searching for the driver. Once we find a driver, we go to the state called driver found. Once the driver is found, we send you a notification, okay, we found a driver for you, this is his details, and he'll be arriving in these many minutes. Once the driver arrives, he picks you up, and the booking starts, your ride starts. And once it's finished, we pay the driver and charge you for the ride. So throughout this flow, there were around 30 dependencies. To give you an example, the sync calls were check balance and check for service area. These are called when the booking is created. So you don't want this to be async, otherwise if I don't have enough balance and I get to know that in an async call, it's of no use. So this has to be a sync call. The reserve, so we have our own wallet service called GoPay, where users can put in money and pay for rides. So we also check for the if you have enough balance in that service. Is something changing to the mic? Okay. And then there are async calls like send notification and paying driver and charging the customer. So they don't need to happen in sync, and they can happen sometime later as well. What we wanted to solve was we wanted to remove the 30 dependencies that Ride Service depended on, so that it could be maintained on its own and the uptime would become better. Our initial stab at it was Kafka. So does anyone not know what Kafka is? Okay, in a gist, what Kafka is, a publish-subscribe messaging system. So to go back to that example for the AC, the database where the stream was stored, that is what Kafka is in this case. So now what we did was we moved from a push model to a pull model, a pull model to a push model. So initially, if you wanted to build any service that wanted to access these state changes, that booking created, booking confirmed, they had to ask Ride Service for it, or Ride Service had to make some API call to them. Instead, now what happened was that every time there was a state change, Ride Service would just publish a message on Kafka, and anyone that wanted to use that data, they would just read it off of Kafka. This is basically what is event sourcing. If you want to understand it better, Eric has a really good cast on it. You can check it out. I watched it yesterday, by the way, so. Okay. We thought that Kafka is a great solution and we would start building applications on top of it. But that did not happen in practice, because stream processing itself has its own drawbacks. So you have to handle lag. So there is always eventual consistency. So a lot of services could not handle lag. I mean, they could, but they did not want to put in the effort to do that. Idempotence is also a problem, where the dependent services, they need to be idempotent, because Kafka provides at least once guarantee. So you can have the same message delivered to you twice. So the downstream services need to be idempotent. You need to have error handling in place. So since all of this is async, you cannot cancel the transaction because the processing failed. So there should be error handling in place. And since everything is distributed now, there should be proper monitoring and tracing in place so that you can trace if there is any error. So I hope everyone understood the problem. The problem was that stream processing was not happening in the company and we wanted it to happen. So what was the solution? Our initial stab at it was using Kafka Streams. What Kafka Streams gives you is a really good DSL to read streams from Kafka and process them using a topology, where a topology is a logical representation of data processing in a pipeline. I'll explain what that is in later slides. So we started with a service called Stream Notification Service. What happens is whenever a driver is found for you, we send you a notification. Initially, what happened was that write service would call a push notification service and send notifications to you. But we thought that this could be pulled out as an async, because this is an async call, this can be pulled out. And since this is not a critical thing where even if you do not get the notification, it's not a big deal, this could be a good proof of concept initially. So this is something that we pulled out, and it took us two months to develop this service, where we pulled out all the notifications from write service and created a service called Stream Notification Service using Kafka Streams. So this is what the topology looked like. So here, basically what's happening is you get a message and here you define how you want to process that message. So you have a lot of maps and filters in place where you say that, okay, this map this function to this message, filter this message out based on some logic, right? So let's understand this, as this will be really vital to understand later problems. So all the messages that we push into Kafka in Gojek are serialized using the protobuf format. The first thing that we do essentially is to deserialize that proto and to get a closure map out of it. So this is that's what's happening here, where we're deserializing the proto and getting a closure map. After that, what we do is, so this is an application logic where any service that you write on Kafka, you have to do this. This was something that's related to the domain logic of Stream Notification Service. So we provide ride hailing for a lot of service types. Say we have bikes, we have cars, we have a third service called Bluebird. So we wanted to send notifications only for bikes. So we are filtering out all the other service types. Then we are logging and reporting metrics for each message. So this is something that we've kept in mind throughout from the starting, where we log and send metrics for every message that we receive, as monitoring is a huge problem with stream processing. Then what we do is we filter values based on ordering. So if it is an older message, so if the booking is already completed, you don't want to send a notification for driver found, right? So my booking is already completed, why are you sending me a notification that you found a driver for me? So you want to filter those messages out, and you also want to filter out old messages. I don't want to get a notification half an hour later. So this was where we were handling lag problems. This was again a domain related to Stream Notification Service. And finally, what we're doing is we are mapping the main function that dispatches notification to every message. This was a fairly successful solution, and Stream Notification Service has been working fine since then. But what we realized is this IFTTT model, where what happens is an event is generated and you want to do an asynchronous action on that. I hope everyone knows what IFTTT is. It's a really cool app. You should try it out. It's available on Android and iOS, right? So what we want to do here is something similar to that, where whenever an event is created, you want to do some action on top of that. This is again a tedious task, because for every application that you build, you have to connect, you have to write code that connects to Kafka Stream, you have to set up monitoring, you have to handle errors, and you have to handle duplication of messages. Now, as Shantanu mentioned in his talk, because this logic will be duplicated across all services, it's straightforward. I mean, it's obvious to pull out a framework for this. And I agree with all the reasons that Shantanu gave. So basically, that's what we did as well. We pulled out a framework and we called it Ziggurat. So after pulling out Ziggurat, this is what the topology looked like, where we said that, okay, initially we'll deserialize the proto, we'll log metrics for it, and you give us a mapper function, and we'll apply that mapper function to every message that we receive from that stream. if you notice here, we lose the ability to filter out messages and to basically do the maps and filters that you can easily do using for message processing. But what we gain is a non-leaky abstraction where we abstract out Kafka streams and topology for the user, and all the user has to provide is a mapper function that will be applied to every stream. And this is what the interface for Ziggurat looked like. So from the starting, what we've maintained is to have a single interface for Ziggurat, and also any logic that you write, you only have to pass your function to one function of Ziggurat, that is the init main function, and that will handle everything else. So this was the initial interface, and we'll go through how the interface has changed throughout the evolutions. So now, if you go back to the inspectable example, what we have is we can now read from a stream, and we can do monitoring on our streams. Okay, before I go ahead, I'll talk a lot about actors. And the services that we build, we call them actors and explain why. So there is something called the actor model that is taken from Akka or Erlang, where each actor is basically a processing entity. It could be a service or it could be a process running on a thread. Basically what it does is it gets all its messages, it gets all its data from immutable messages. Every actor has its own mailbox, that is its own offset as to what message it has to read next. And more or less all the actors are stateless. And that is what we're trying to do with our model as well. Where all our services, they get all their messages from Kafka. These messages are immutable. Kafka Streams acts as the mailbox for every service. And we try to keep this actor stateless so that we can easily scale up and scale down our services. So for our use case, actors are basically services that use Ziggurat and read from Kafka Streams. Okay. So now we can read from Kafka and we have some monitoring in place. Then a problem came up to us was that we wanted to move a service called payments. We wanted to create a service called payments processor. What it did essentially was that whenever a booking is created, what we do is we reserve balance for the customer. So if the customer is paying via GoPay, our wallet, what we want to do is that if the ride costs say $30, we want to reserve that balance so that he does not spend that during the trip, right? But whenever the booking is canceled, you want to reverse that balance. You want to give the customer back that balance. And initially that was done by ride service. Again, this is an async task, so we can pull this out. The way this is different from stream notification service is that in this we need error handling in place. So for example, if the reverse balance API call fails for some reason, you don't want to just skip it because you can't take away money from people, right? So you want to retry that message. So what is the obvious solution for this? You could just not go ahead and keep on retrying that message until it succeeds. But what if the downstream service, say GoPay, is actually down? Now, there's no point in retrying it right now, right? And you'll just block the stream. So essentially what we did was we have our own solution that I'll explain that retries the message after some configured time. So essentially what we do is that whenever a message errors out, we put it in a RabbitMQ queue with the configured delay. So let's say the delay is 5 seconds. So we put it in a delay queue with a time to live of 5 seconds. Whenever that time to live finishes, whenever 5 seconds are done, that message is then put into an instant queue from which the service reads it back again. So essentially now what you have is a 5 second delay in retrying of messages. And then you can configure it to, have this flow 5 times, say, and say that, okay, I'll retry this message 5 times, and if it fails all the time, then I'll put it into your dead set queue. Now the actor does not retry messages from the dead set queue automatically. What you have to do is you have to make an API call to the actor, and then it retries those messages again. So how did the interface change? If you look at the interface, it remains the same. But what Ziggurat started expecting now are 3 keywords, success, retry, or skip. So as the word suggests, when we return success, Ziggurat just moves on. When you say retry, it puts the message into a RabbitMQ queue. And when we say skip, it just logs it and skips the message and moves on to the next one. So how did Ziggurat handle this? The first thing that we did was we have the execution of the mapper function in a try catch. So if the user, he has some exception is being raised, we don't want the actor to shut down. So what we do is we catch that error, we catch that exception, log it, send it to Sentry, and then we put it into a RabbitMQ queue to be retried. So this is how we handle errors that are unintended. After that, let's say now payments processor, what it wanted to do was, let's say you have a handler function from which you're processing a message. If you return a success code, Ziggurat just logs it and moves on. If you return a retry code, it puts into a RabbitMQ queue. So producer retry here is putting that message into a queue. And if you return skip, you just again log in and move ahead to the other message. And what did the code for payments processor look like? It looked like something like this, where now what you're doing is you're first, so you're making an API call. So the API call is cancel reservation. If the return is success, you just return success. And if you don't get the wallet ID or if the return is failure, you retry. And if it is a client error, there's no point in retrying it because your API call is wrong. So we just skip it. So now that we have the error handling in place, error reporting is also done. So all that Inspector Cool needs now is an HTTP server and the ability to read from multiple streams. Now we come to API routes. So a new request came to us for an actor called Nearby Driver Actor. So whenever you try to book a ride on the app, on your Uber app or on the Gojek app, you see that there are a couple of drivers nearby, near your location, and this is the service that enables us to do it in Gojek. So basically what happens is your app makes an API call to a service that in turn makes an API call to Nearby Driver Actor, which fetches the drivers that are near your location and returns those. How it does is that we have a stream, a topic called available driver location pings on Kafka. The service reads that data, it processes that data and massages it and puts it into Redis, where the key is the S2 ID of that location, right? So whenever the app makes a call with their own S2 ID, we just fetch the S2 ID that equates to the S2 ID sent in the request and return all the drivers in that area. The problem here was we did not have an HTTP server in Ziggurat. Actually, we did, but we did not expose it. So the obvious solution was to set up a web server, add middleware to it so that it can parse requests and construct responses, and then start and stop the server gracefully in the actor. And actually, that's what we did. But then we realized that Ziggurat already did this. So if you go back to the retry example, for retrying DeadSet, we provide APIs. And for that, we need to set up a web server in Ziggurat. So we thought that we already have a web server. Why not give you an interface to have your own routes on that web server? So that's what we did. And this is what the interface looks like now, where you pass in the handler function that is applied to every stream along with the API routes. And the API routes here are a vector of routes as defined by BD. That's a library in Clojure. So the example is this. So this is what Nearby Driver Service code looks like, where the route is Gojek service type, where you give the service type and the handler function for that API. So Ziggurat now supports APIs. You can pass in your own APIs and it will host them. So now all that is left is to have multiple streams, the ability to read from multiple streams. Then comes in Passbook Clerk, where you say that, okay, so now what happens is you have a problem where you want to pay the drivers. You pay the drivers and the drivers need to know how they have earned, what all they have earned throughout the day. So in what all ways can a driver earn? So whenever you whenever a driver completes a booking, he gets paid for that. Customers can pay drivers, can tip drivers. So that happens through GoPay. So driver needs to know how much he has earned in tips. And he also gets bonus after a couple of rides based on some of our domain logic. So now there are three ways that a driver can earn. And all of these three are different streams in Kafka. Ideally, how you would solve it with the current version of Ziggurat is you would say that, with the version that we're talking about now, is you would set up three different actors that read from these three streams and they aggregate that into a single service from which the driver can get the data. But now a discussion about monoliths versus microservices comes up, where monoliths have a problem that they have a high development cost as there is no separation of concerns. So you have really jumbled up code and it's really hard to develop on it and maintain it. Uptime is also a problem since it has a lot of dependencies. On the other hand, microservices are really good at this, But the problem there is that it has high maintenance in terms of the number of services. So at Gojek, there are only around 150 to 160 of us, but we have around 400 microservices. So it is not feasible to maintain these many services and build new services on top of that. And infra cost is also a problem. So what we did is we found a sweet spot where now we have separation of concern in the code base, but still as an abstraction, an actor can run as three different actors. I'll explain how. So now what we did was now a single actor can read from three streams and process each of the streams separately on their own threads. So even if a stream failed, if anything happened, only that part of the actor would stop working. Everything else would run fine. This is how we did that. So we introduced something called a stream router. So basically what a stream router is like a normal HTTP router where it takes in a stream and routes it to a handler function. And this is what the API looks like now. If you pay attention to what stream ID is, it is just a namespace for all the APIs, the config, metrics, and retries for that particular stream. So when I said that there is still separation of concern, what I meant by that is that for each stream, you can have different number of threads running for each stream. You can actually read from different clusters of Kafka, and the actor would run fine. Each could have their own offset on Kafka, and each would read from a different, could read from a different topic, have different protos, and everything would work fine. So as I said, as an abstraction, they would run as separate services, but still on the same infra and in the same code base. So this is what the actor for passbook log, the code for passbook log looked like, where you said that, okay, I want to read from driver bonus, driver tip, and booking topics. Each of them are handled by a different handler function. And it made sense to have them in a single code base because the handler function more or less looks something like this, where it constructs the body for that message. Now this construct body part is separate for each stream, but everything else is the same. So you make an API call and then you handle if that call succeeds or fails. And for each of these streams, now you can manage your own config. So say if driver bonus stream does not have a lot of throughput, you'll just have one thread for it. And if the driver tip stream has a lot of throughput, you can have three or four threads for it and everything will work fine. So now with this version of Ziggurat, we can build our inspector cool application and everything will work fine. But this is not where we stopped in Ziggurat, as we faced a technical problem that was not part of this example. So let me explain the problem. So we faced a new problem with a service called Chatter. Now what Chatter does was that whenever a driver is found, what you want to do is that you want to create a chat room between the driver and the customer. So what I want is that whenever a driver is found for me, I want to talk to that driver. The problem here was the third party service that creates the chat room that was really slow. The 99th percentile was around 1 second. And we have a lot of throughput on the booking topic that this actor was processing. So we had high lags. And it was a really bad customer experience where my driver was found, but after 5 minutes, the chat room would be created. So what is the obvious solution for this? You just increase the number of consumers, you read more messages parallelly. But here is where we face the technical problem with Kafka Streams. So Kafka Streams does not let you parallelize, does not let you have more consumers than the number of partitions you have in that topic. So let's say you have four partitions and you have two consumers, everything will work fine. The moment you hit the sixth consumer mark, the sixth consumer would stop reading from Kafka Streams. If you have four partitions, only four consumers will continue reading, and the fifth partition will stay. The fifth consumer will stay idle. So we could not increase the number of consumers. So what did we do now? We started syncing all the messages into RabbitMQ. And then since RabbitMQ does not have a constraint on the number of consumers, you could easily scale up the consumers here. And that is what we did. So basically we started reading from Kafka, putting all the messages into RabbitMQ, and then set up 15, 20 consumers on RabbitMQ and process the messages parallelly. I'll explain this better with an example as to how this works. So let's say you have a producer that produces to a topic called Flash at the rate of 10 messages per second, right? And you only have two partitions on that. So now to have no lag in this service, what you need to do is your mapper function should process the message at a rate of around 5 messages per second on each consumer. So your mapper function execution time should be around 200 ms. But let's say our execution time is 500 ms. Now we have a lag problem where we can only process 4 messages per minute per second. I hope you're understanding this. Okay. Now what we do is we only have 2 consumers. We sync all the messages into RabbitMQ, and since RabbitMQ is really it does not take a lot of time to sync message into that. You can sync them really quickly. And then you set up 5 consumers that run on the same infra. So each consumer consumes at a message of 2 messages per second, and you now you can process your message at 10 messages per second. So this was a solution that worked great, and Chatter has been working in production for a couple of months now. And this is what the interface looks like now, where you say that, okay, for each stream, for a stream, I have this handler function, and then I have a channel ID where I say that, okay, put all the messages into this channel, and then I'll process it later. And the channel handler function is the message that processes the message that comes from the RabbitMQ queue. Again, this is not related at all to closure channels, so please don't get confused. To give you an example, this is what Chatter pseudo code looks like, where you say that, okay, I have a handler function, a room creation channel, and a room deletion channel. So all the messages are still first, the main function still gets the message first, and you can decide which channel to sync that message into. So if it is a booking created event, I'll sync that message into a room creation channel, otherwise I'll sync it into a room deletion channel, right? And then once you sync that message, the room creation function that you look at the top of the code, that handles all the message that it reads from the room creation queue in RabbitMQ. And that creates that calls the create room message and returns a success. So even now we have all the error handling in place for each channel, where if you return a retry, that message is put into a RabbitMQ that goes through this entire flow again. So again, this is what I'm explaining here. And this is what the config looks like. So for each channel, you can configure the number of workers you want. So I say that room creation, room deletion does not have that much load, but room creation might have a lot of load. So you can have different number of consumers in each of those. Okay, so this is how Ziggurat evolved over time, but all of this will be useless if it's not used in production at all. So let's see how it has impacted Gojek. We have more than 51 services that are running in production that use Ziggurat. And they've been running fine for like, so the first service was written around a year ago, and it has been running fine since then. As I mentioned that the first service, stream notification service that we wrote in using Kafka streams, that took us 2 months to build. A similar service today takes us around a week to build. So if you extrapolate that to 50 actors, that's around 150 weeks worth of effort saved for a pair of programmers. So we've saved more than 3 years of effort in a year using Ziggurat. Yeah, that requires clap, man. And the actor that introduced error handling in Ziggurat, that handles more than 70% of all the payments that go through Gojek. And it works at a load of around 41,000 messages per minute, but that is not the highest load that we handled. Some of our actors handle more than 2 million messages per minute. And they run fine in production, everything works fine. Okay, this is something interesting. So as I said, we built a framework to handle stream processing, right? Live tracking is an important problem where each of our product requires live tracking for drivers. So you want to know where the driver is right now. How live tracking works is that we have the driver location on Kafka. We sync those messages into a Redis, and then the app or a service, they just use that cache to get the latest location for a driver. So we built a service using Ziggurat that did this. So basically it was a Redis sync. And what we saw that over time, people started forking the code and just changing the config to have their own Redis and input topic in place, and they started deploying it. So now what people have done is they've templatized live tracking and basically a Redis sync. And now you can set up live tracking for any product in a couple of minutes, and everything will work fine using Ziggurat. To have a recap, we abstracted out Kafka streams using Sense. Then we had error handling in place using payments processor. Then we added an HTTP server interface using Passbook Clerk. Then we had a stream router, and finally we added channels. And this is how the interface has changed over time. So initially there was no change, but it started accepting keywords, that is success, retry, skip. After that, we added API routes. Now I'd like to mention that this is still an optional parameter. So if you don't want any routes, you just don't pass it and it'll work fine. Then this was a breaking change in Ziggurat, where instead of passing a handler function simply, now we have a stream router, and then to a stream router we pass a handler function. And finally, we added channels. Channels is again an optional feature. If you don't pass anything, it will still run fine. And one more doubt, if any of you might have, it is that RabbitMQ is an optional dependency in Ziggurat. So if you don't want retries and if you don't want channels, you can just turn that off in the config, and you don't need a RabbitMQ in production to run Ziggurat actors. Okay, I'd like to reiterate that we have all our we have open sourced this library. I'd love your feedback, your issues, bug reports on our repo. If anyone of you might have zoned out during the talk, we'll publish this story on our blog. We have a lot of similar stories on our blog. You should definitely check it out. You can reach us at Gojek Tech, and personally you can reach me on my Twitter or GitHub account. Thanks.
Questions, anyone?
I wanted to understand what was the reason of offloading the events to RabbitMQ instead of just creating a new topic with more number of partitions.
Yeah, so we considered that. The thing is that a lot of the times you don't have a control over the producer. So even if you offload it to a new topic with a more number of partitions, what happens in the future when the number of when the load again increases? Would you again put it to a new topic or increase the number of partitions? And also we did not want to duplicate data in our Kafka. So since Kafka stores data even after you read it, what RabbitMQ does is it deletes the data after you read it. So there's we did not want duplication of data.
Okay. So I had another question about the booking service. So how do you handle causality scenarios in case of your booking service? So by causality scenarios, I'll try to explain it with an example. Let's suppose you have a booking service, and let's say you have a driver cancellation service. Now the booking service has made a booking confirmation. Mm-hmm. And let's say, as you said, that all your notifications are asynchronous, and there has been a GC pause on your booking service, and the booking confirmation notification hasn't yet reached, and the driver has in the meanwhile cancelled the booking, and had sent a booking cancelled notification to the notification service, and the notification had reached the user. And later on, when the GC pause, the JVM resumes the operation, it sends a booking confirmation notification to the user. So how do you handle scenarios like these where a causality is involved?
So it depends on where the lag is. As you said, the GC paused, right? So if it paused on the actor, as in on the service that makes the call to the notification service, that is an edge case that we haven't handled yet. So the notification would still go out. But if the lag is on Kafka, we still handle that case where we have our ordering in place using a cache. So if the lag is on Kafka, if we got the booking completed, the booking, so the driver found notification first and then the driver cancelled, we would not send the driver found one because of the cache.
Okay.
Any more questions?
Okay. Thanks a lot.
Thank you.